Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Fight for Lizzie Flowers by Carol Rivers. Read by Helen Dickens. The Fight for Lizzie Flowers was written for you, my readers. December 1932. It was a sunny winter's morning, and ladders of gold streamed in through the registry office windows. It was also the last Wednesday before Christmas, and Lizzie rejoiced in the fact that, at last, in her 27th year, she would be married to the love of her life, Danny Flowers. The scene was set, low-key, no frills, just as she had wanted. Beside Danny stood Bert, her brother and best man. The ring was poised carefully between his great, clumsy fingers, ready to pass to the groom. Bert's towering 6'4" frame strained every stitch of his ill-fitting wedding suit, his presence giving her a feeling of reassurance, as did her good friends Lil and Doug Sharp, seated in the row behind, the only witnesses to today's brief civil ceremony. Lizzie looked into Danny's clear blue eyes, spaced evenly in his handsome, weather-beaten face. A jagged scar on his forehead was still visible, the handiwork of her late husband, Frank, Danny's older brother. Thankfully, nature had healed the vertical slash of smooth, pale skin, and Danny's blonde hair fell lightly across it, disguising any unsightliness. But the thought of Frank and the violence he had been capable of still made her shiver. Uncannily, a door ground open at the back of the room, and her mother's words flashed into mind.
"Someone's just walked over my grave, Lizzie girl. There's on my neck a standing on end."
But why had she thought of that now? Lizzie wondered, as Danny took her hand in his. Frank was dead and buried, a swollen, almost unrecognisable corpse dragged from the River Thames 7 months ago, now laid to rest in East London Cemetery. She and Danny were to be man and wife today. Nothing could spoil this moment, not even those painful memories she had buried, sealed and locked away, and hoped would fade completely as the years passed. Danny moved closer. His tall, powerful figure was dressed impeccably in a hand-finished black suit and silk tie. Thick blonde waves parted on his crown and a smile curved over his even white teeth. Lizzie's heart lifted in anticipation. This was a moment she had dreamed of since Danny had sailed out of her life to seek his fortune in Australia almost 12 years ago. She had loved him then. She loved him now. It was as if she had never lost him, never taken his brother for her husband, and lived to regret it. Chapter 1. "I love you," Danny whispered, tracing his thumb gently over her fingers. "Always and forever this time." Her heart raced, missing yet another beat.
"Always and forever," she repeated,
her voice lost as the registrar, pasty-faced and squat, cleared his throat noisily. The door rattled again. Danny held her gaze, as though forbidding her to turn round. She saw Bert pass Danny the ring, and the golden band gleamed, poised to glide effortlessly over her finger. But it was as if her eyes couldn't help themselves, as if, in slow motion, she turned, the minute details of the room imprinting themselves on her mind. The shabby wallpaper, the well-thumbed reference books on the shelves, a vase of white chrysanthemums placed on a small table, and a sprig of holly pinned precariously above the handwritten notice, wishing the public at large a festive Christmas and a happy New Year.
"Oh, Christ, it can't be," she heard Lil gasp behind her.
In that moment,
Lizzie's world began to crumble. The feeling of unreality she had been trying so hard to suppress all day now fully encompassed her. The man, the intruder, was walking towards them. A dark fedora shaded his eyes. A camel-coloured coat was buttoned over his chest. But it was the two-tone brown and white brogues that sent real fear throughout her body. Shoes that were her late husband's trademark in life. And so, Danny had told her, in death. Lizzie shook her head, refusing to believe what she saw. If this was a ghost, then everyone else was seeing it too. Lil and Doug stood, open-mouthed, staring at the figure in the aisle. The registrar frowned, a look of annoyance on his face at the interruption. But it was Danny who stepped forward and squared his shoulders, confronting the apparition.
Frank? But you're supposed to be...
Bran bread?
Frank acknowledged, his pale blue eyes moving uncertainly in their red-rimmed sockets. Lizzie felt fingers of ice on her neck. Frank! Her dead husband was here in this room. The same man Danny had identified in Limehouse Morgue back in May.
But it can't be you,
Danny said.
I saw you, fished out of the river.
Not me, Frank replied softly. Sorry to disappoint.
Is this some sick joke? Danny demanded. What are you playing at, Frank?
This ain't no game, Danny. I'm flesh and blood standing here, same as you.
But I saw what I saw, Danny insisted. It was you.
Floaters a ten a penny in the docks,
Frank interrupted with a slight shrug.
You should have took a closer gander.
Before Danny could reply, the registrar spoke.
Who are you, sir? This is a private ceremony with invited guests only.
You better ask her.
Frank nodded at Lizzie, but she was speechless. Like Danny, she couldn't believe this was Frank. He was thinner and paler than he used to be, his cheeks sunken under his eyes, but he was still wearing his trademark stacked shoulders overcoat and ridiculous two-tone brogues.
Mrs. Flowers, the registrar prompted.
But Lizzie could only shake her head as she tried to speak.
I don't know, she mumbled at last,
her voice a distant echo in her ears.
He is...
Alive and kicking, Frank said quietly. Last time I saw you, girl, I was on my way out of this world, and no one is more surprised than me to be standing here in one piece. But this time, you have my word I ain't here to make trouble.
Your word?
Danny repeated incredulously.
Why the hell should anyone take your word? You're nothing but bad news, Frank. And though you are family, and in all conscience I should be relieved that it wasn't a brother of mine they fished out of the river, I am truly gutted.
As the two men faced each other, all Lizzie could think was, why in God's name had she married a man like Frank Flowers? She could still smell his drunken breath on their wedding night, feel his hands ripping at her clothes. The dream had turned to a nightmare. She had been blind, naive, and worst of all, she had lost Danny.
Get out of here,
Danny continued with quiet menace.
You ain't welcome, Frank. This is my and Lizzie's day. We are going to finish what we came here for.
Problem is, Frank said, slowly raising his eyes, the law thinks different.
Suddenly, Lizzie understood what was truly happening. It didn't matter where Frank had been or why he was here. The sad truth was, there wouldn't be, couldn't be, any marriage today. No blushing bride or wedding kiss after Danny had slipped the ring on her finger. No congratulations and confetti on the registry office steps. No wedding breakfast. Gone was the plan knees up, the tinkling of ivories and serious drinking until dawn. Frank had robbed her of happiness once again.
"Come, come," the registrar exclaimed impatiently. "Please, either leave or be seated, Mr.
Flowers," Frank provided. "This lady here is my wife."
The silence in the small room was deafening. Lizzie could hear her own heartbeat. No one moved or drew a breath.
"It's true, ain't it, Lizzie?"
Frank insisted.
"You and me tied the knot. When was it? Must be all of 7 years back."
"Wife?"
the little man repeated as he turned to Lizzie.
"But you have applied as a widow to be married here today."
Lizzie felt her face flush. She stared at Frank and into his expectant gaze.
Yes, I was," she faltered, "but there's been some kind of mistake."
"Obviously,"
the official replied, and taking the ledger in front of him, he snapped it closed, pushing it to one side of the desk with an expression of undisguised anger. Chapter 2. A bead of sweat rolled down Lizzie's back. Her two-piece suit, the perfect shade of green that she loved and only a shade lighter than her deep sea-green eyes, was clinging uncomfortably to her skin. Her jaunty, narrow-brimmed hat of the same shade, with a delicate 3 inches of embroidered veil, felt a mockery now. She heard Danny breathing hard, watching Frank as he stepped towards her.
"You're the one good thing that's happened to me, Lizzie. And I'd cut off my right arm if I could change what I did. I've seen the error of me ways, and I reckon, if we gave it a shot, you and me could make a go of it. It's never too late to change."
Lizzie glared in disbelief at the man who had cheated on her from day one of their marriage. Not caring how much he hurt her or how deeply she had been humiliated, staring into his face, she felt the breath leave her lungs as she shook her head.
"Listen to you, Frank. Listen to what you are saying. After all that's happened, do you really believe there could be a future for us? Look at me. Look at Danny. We're here to begin a new life. A life that, until you walked into this room, we'd intended to make together."
"But you can't leave me now, Lizzie,"
Frank pleaded, opening his arms and gazing into her eyes.
"Not now. Not now I've sorted myself out. And I have. Honest to God, I have. On my life, Lizzie, they only just unlocked the door. Can't you see I'm Jen this time?"
Lizzie's head started to reel.
"What door?"
"I've been ill, girl. Really bad. But they cured me. They knocked the shit out of me in the hospital."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.